Here is a new lesson on production trees and utility functions. To work on a better representation of production, we will very often use production trees. This representation in the form of production tree is interesting because it's very flexible. It allows the modeler to reflect on the best way to represent production, with, of course, the possibility of differentiating the modelizations of production from one sector to another. We had very simplified representations of production. What we are going to do is already going from two productive factors to four productive factors. It's up to you to introduce more than four factors into the study you are going to conduct if you think it is useful. We will also see that complementarity between factors of production or substitutability can easily be included. The idea being to first draw a production tree, then to translate it into equation. It's easy to do. So, what will we change in these representations of production? I remind that we presented production in each sector as a Leontief of total value added and total intermediate consumption. A Leontief functions introduces the idea of complementarity. Then total intermediate consumption is the Leontief functions of the intermediate consumption of each good in each sector. Value added is a Cobb-Douglas functions of capital and labor. This is the second part of the representations of productions that we already did. The Cobb-Douglas function introduces the idea that the value shares, here capital and labor, are constant in the value of production as production changes. So what are we going to change? First, four factors will be introduced instead of two: land, skilled labor, unskilled labor, and capital. Then we will introduce the fact that land is only used in agricultural sectors. And then we will introduce an idea that we find in many computable general equilibrium models. Skilled labor is rather complementary to capital, and when we substitute machines for labor, we tend in all sectors to substitute machines for unskilled workers. So in fact, to be more precise, what we are going to do is that when we replace workers with machines, we are in fact substituting a composite factor, which is the additions of skilled labor and capital to unskilled labor. This is what we are going to include in these new representations of production. So here is the new production tree. So this is the new representation of production in our model. So production of I is denoted Y in sector I and is a Leontief function of value added in sector I, VA in sector I, and total intermediate consumption in sector I, denoted IC in sector I. On the right side, nothing changes, and total intermediate consumption in sector I is a Leontief function of the intermediate consumption of good J by sector I, denoted Cij, Ji. Then, on the left side, this is where there are some innovations as compared to the previous representations of production. Value added in sector I, VA in sector I, is a CES function with an elasticity of 1.1, which is relatively high, of land in sector I, denoted land in sector I, unskilled labor in sector I, denoted LD in sector I, and a composite factor, denoted Q in sector I. And this composite factor, Q in sector I, is a CES function with an elasticity of 0.6, which is relatively low, of skilled labor in sector I, which is called SKLD in sector I, and capital in sector I, which is denoted KD in sector I. So the idea is that the elasticity of substitution between skilled labor and capital is relatively low, so they are rather complementary than substitutable. And when we replace unskilled workers by machines, in fact, here we've got a replacement of unskilled workers by a combination of skilled workers and machines. So we model production as the relative of value added and total intermediate consumption. It means that value added and total intermediate consumption are complementary in volume terms. So there is no change here as compared to the previous versions of the model. So the first level of the Leontief consists in three equations. Two equations of demand in volume, of value added and total intermediate consumption. So a first one, which is VA in sector I, is equal to a parameter denoted psi underscore VA in sector I times Y in sector I. And IC in sector I must be equal to a parameter denoted psi underscore IC in sector I multiplied by Y in sector I. So these are relations of proportionality in volume between value added and production on one side and total intermediate consumption and productions on the other side. The third equation is PY in sector I times Y in sector I is equal to PVA in sector I times VA in sector I plus PIC in sector I times IC in sector I. It simply means that the total value of production is equal to the sum of the value added and the value of total intermediate consumption. Then there is a second level of Leontief relating total intermediate consumption of sector J and intermediate consumption of good I by sector J. The first equation is PIC in sector J times IC in sector J must be equal to sum over I of PI times CIJ IJ. It simply means that the value of total intermediate consumption in sector J is equal to the sum of the intermediate consumption of goods I by sector J. And then there is a second equation, which is CIJ IJ must be equal to a parameter, which is denoted psi over psi underscore IJ C I J times IC in sector J. So it expresses a demand of good I by sector J. In volume, it is a fixed proportion of total intermediate consumption. So now let's move on to the value added side. This is where the innovations are. We have assumed that value added is a CES function of land, unskilled labor, and a composite factor that combines skilled labor and capital. The first level consists of four equations, always one equation linking the levels in value, and three equations that established demands expressed in volume, because we have three productive factors, land, unskilled labor, and the composite factor. So the first equation is therefore PVA in sector I times VA in sector I must be equal to W multiplied by 1 plus TVA in sector I multiplied by LD in sector I plus PQ in sector I times Q in sector I plus R land, which is the remuneration of land, times 1 plus TVA in sector I times land in sector I. And here I have a condition which is dollar land 0 in sector I. So the total value added is the sum of the value of unskilled labor used in the sector, the value of land used in the sector, and the value of the composite factor employed in the sector. It includes the tax that companies must pay when they buy this productive factor, and you see this tax on unskilled labor and land. Concerning the composite factor, the tax will be expressed at the next level of the representations of production, and PVA is a composite price of value added. We add the value of land used in the production only in the agricultural sector, so that's why I added to this value of land the condition, the parameter land zero in sector I is strictly positive. This means that if in this sector there was initially land used for production, then it is a sector where we must include the total added value of land which is employed in the sector. I remind you that dollar land zero in sector I means if, this is the signification of dollar, if the parameter land zero is strictly positive. Then there are three relations that express the demand in volume terms of unskilled labor, composite factor and land, the latter equation being only present in the agricultural sector, hence the condition dollar land zero in sector I put close to the name of the equation. This relationship are of the form, if we move VA from the right side to the left side of the equation, this is a ratio of demands, demand of a specific factor, productive factor in volume in a sector to value added in volume in that sector. So this ratio is equal to a constant multiplied by a ratio of prices, composite price of value added of a price of the factor in question, tax included, and this ratio of prices is at the power, a parameter called sigma underscore VA in sector I, which is the elasticity of substitution. So for example, we have LD in sector I over VA in sector I is equal to A underscore L in sector I times PVA in sector I over W1 plus TVA in sector I. So this ratio at the power sigma underscore VA in sector I. I recommend that you do not write this equation by writing LD divided by VA, but LD must be equal to A underscore L VA, the ratio of price at the power sigma underscore VA. Why? Because if you want to derive this expression, it's easier if you write it this way. So if the price of unskilled labor, including taxes, increases, the demand for unskilled labor will be reduced since sigma underscore VA is positive. Then we have the second level of the CES. So the composite factor Q in sector I is a CES of skilled labor and capital. So at this level, we have three equations. So again, an equation relating the value of the composite factor PQ times Q must be equal to the value of capital and the value of skilled labor. The value added tax must be included here. And then you have two equations which are demands of skilled labor and capital. And so they have the same form as the one that we just presented. S key LD in sector J divided by Q in sector J if you move Q from the right side to the left side is equal to a parameter A underscore SK LD in sector J multiplied by a ratio of prices at the power, a new elasticity of substitution, which is sigma underscore CAP in this sector. So in the ratio of prices, you have the ratio of the price of the composite price PQ in sector J divided by WES multiplied by 1 plus the value added tax. So it means that when either WS or TVA is augmented, the demand for this factor, skilled labor, is reduced. Let's now look at how the modeling of demand can be changed. Previously, there was a Club Douglas utility function defined on the consumption of the three goods by households. The advantage of the Club Douglas function is that it is very easy to calibrate. You just need the budget shares of each good in the total household expenditure. So you only need the shares of agricultural goods, industrial goods, and services in the total household expenditure. The first problem is that with the Cobb-Douglas, price elasticities are equal to 1. So when the price of a good increases by 1%, the demand for that good always decreases by 1% in volume. Second problem, unit income elasticities are equal to 1. So when household incomes increases by 1%, the demand for each good also increases by 1%. And third problem, cross elasticities are equal to 0. So if there is an increase by 1% of the price of a good, it has no impact on the demand for the other goods. This is obviously a big problem because it includes numerous and severe restrictions on household consumption. So there are other options than Cobb-Douglas. We can use either a constant elasticity of substitution, a CES, or a linear expenditure system, or LES, or an expanded linear expenditure system, which is also called ELES. And of course, there are other ways of representing consumers' demand. You already know the CES function. CES means constant elasticity of substitution. The CES is relatively easy to calibrate. A certain level of substitution elasticity is assumed, and shared parameters are calibrated from the demand equation of each good in volume. What is interesting about the CES is that price elasticities are variable. To find the formulas for this elasticity of demand relative to price, I recommend that you search into the literature on this question. On the other hand, the elasticity of substitutions of demand between two goods is constant. It is the definitions of these functions. Lastly, income elasticities with the CES are always equal to 1. So when consumer income increases by 1%, the demand for a good also increases by 1%. This is not true. This is not confirmed by reality. We know that for some goods, this demand increases by less than 1%, while for others, it increases by more than 1%. So we are going to present a new utility function, which is the linear expenditure system, or LES. This LES is more difficult to calibrate. A few parameters are needed. This is parameters that we call minimal consumption. We will adopt here a very simple hypothesis. It is the fact that minimal consumption in agriculture is 80% of the initial consumption in agriculture. So the consumer cannot go below 80% of his current consumption if he wants to reach a certain level of satisfaction. And this proportion is 60% in industry and 20% in services. I let you consult the literature on the subject and think about this question if you wish to explore this point further. But here, this is the hypothesis that we make. With the LES, price elasticities are variable and income elasticities are variable. And these are, of course, interesting properties. So we suppose that households' utility functions is a LES. Equations become U is equal to the product of a I of the difference between C in sector I and C mean in sector I at the power gamma. So it looks like the Cobb-Douglas, except that what is put at the power gamma is not the volume of consumption, but the difference between consumption in volume and minimal consumption. And there is another equation, which is Pi times the difference between Ci and C mean in sector I must be equal to gamma times 1 minus MPS times disp underscore inc minus sum over j of pj times c min in sector j. So it means the price of each good times the difference between consumption in level and minimal consumption is equal to the gamma parameter times what is usually called residual income or supernumerary, This is the difference between the disposable income of the consumer, which doesn't go to savings, so the household income allocated to consumption, and the sum of minimal consumption multiplied by prices. Remember that in this model, the consumption of capital goods follow a Cobb-Douglas, public consumption follows a Cobb-Douglas, and total absorption, that is to say the sum of household consumption, intermediate consumption, public consumption, and consumption of capital goods, follows an Armington, that is to say a CES. Here is the social accounting matrix adapted to this new model. The only changes are that there are 4 factors of production instead of 2. So each sector demands for these factors. In fact, the agricultural sector demands for 4 factors, while the industrial and services sector only demands for 3, because they do not demand for land. Then the income of the household comes from the possession of the 4 factors of production. So in the household, in the row households, in the columns production factor, we have the payment of these incomes to the households. We can check that the sum of all the elements of a row is equal to the sum of all the elements of the corresponding column. Here is the assignment I ask you to do from the program available on the platform entitled C2M2P3 ENG students.gms. You have to study a 2 percentage point increase in value-added tax, except in the agricultural sector where this tax is not modified. You will explain the impact on production volume in each sector.